for the country. It's called TIFAC. The full form is a little long, but it stands for Technology Information Forecasting Assessment Council. We are an autonomous body supported by the Department of Science and Technology. Long back in 95-96, Dr. Kalam used to be our chairman. At that time, we had developed India's Vision 2020. And right now, we are developing India's Vision 2035. We're expecting next few months to launch that. It will cover almost all the important sectors for the country, including starting from energy, environment, agriculture, water, habitat, information, communication, technology, infrastructure, transportation. Everything is being covered through that. And some of the discussions that are going on were relevant to that. But right now, I'm going to change my hat here and talk as a scientist that I've been working for earlier time before I joined this job. This will be slightly different. I'm going to move very fast because time is extremely short. So, the work all that has been done at the University of Dhirubhai Ambani of ICT Gandhinagar, very close to the GIFT city that was being discussed. Let me leave out the details, but our focus in the group was on developing full applications and not just working part of it. I will cover two parts, the wildlife part and the technology for persons with disability. The title originally of this session was Green Environment and Smart Environment. Now it's been changed to Smart Environment, so I'll try to cover both of them, but very fast, just to expose you to the kind of work we've done. What is about wildlife? There are four kind of projects. One is GPS-based tracking. Now, GPS-based tracking is very common, but you use satellite communication. In this particular case, what we did was do animal-to-animal communication. So we avoid the satellites. The cost comes down tremendously. The testing we are doing is, you can see this is the testing has been done on the cow. And there's a live data of the movement of cow. This is very close where the GIFT city is coming out. The cow was moving around that area. This is the next one. This is the Wildlife Institute campus, Wildlife Institute of India, Dehradun. A little turtle which does not go into water. Normally we think of turtle, we think it goes into water. There's a hill turtle, very cute looking animal, less than 500 grams in weight. So for tracking of this, we put something on the body of the animal. We set up a grid of sensing systems which picks up the location through that. So this is to track that animal. But each of these cases, not only track the animal's movement, but also track the microclimate, the activity it is doing. In this particular case, if we go into hibernation, we also know what's going inside. The third one is for monitoring the tiger movement. The tiger has a unique stripe, so we capture the tiger movement in the dark. As it happens, I will leave out the details here. We ran into many problems, but finally we could see in the zoo, we tried this out. And so that the tiger moves in the forest, the data is being transmitted continuously to the researchers. Otherwise, they have to always go and pick up the cousins. They were separated out, like we have in Hindi films, which are, bhai ye mele mein. So these two cousins were separated. They have survived millions of years. That was significance of the fact that we did not know that the species existed. In this particular case, we have taken the sound as a signature. This is another one that I just mentioned, not to talk about. This is to monitor the marine environment. This was an Indo-Australian project that we did not finally take it up. But to monitor coral reef to give us an idea about global warming. This is a project we're doing for the moon mission of India, where we're trying to find out water on the moon by dropping sensors inside the dark craters of the moon at temperatures minus 200 degrees centigrade. It forms the network inside and sends the data. It's the shortest life sensor network because it's not going to last for more than half an hour. Normally we talk of long life network. This was the shortest life because it cannot survive the temperature minus 200 degrees centigrade. Before it dies, it has to give us the information. This is another one that we worked, which was to actually set up a seismic sensor network. It's part of Chandrayaan 2 project, which is not gone, and to do many other things. Again, I'll leave out the details here. Let me come to the technology of persons with disability. Here, actually, you can consider this a smart environment. Sometimes we completely miss this part out when we design our environment. So in this particular case, we looked at persons who could not move their fingers properly. They could not press a remote control button. How do they operate TV? So we started by using gestures of hand to operate TV. For example, the hand goes up, the TV channel goes up, channel goes down, volume goes up. We use hand gesture based on testing at various places. we developed the system. There's one system, there's another system which is split into two parts to make it more flexible. Let me give our details. These are the people trying it out. Some of them in Delhi, also from Delhi. And then we extended this work to cover all kinds of abilities: hand leg movement, head movement, voice, eye movement, facial expressions, thoughts, conscious thoughts, muscle movement, and so on. Based on different technology, what you see on the right hand side of the screen, the green ones are done, that's been given to users, the yellow is done in the lab, and the white is being worked upon. Based on these inputs from any kind of user, we could then make them operate various things, including light, fan, TV, computer, being able to give them speed, and so on, but also make them operate machinery, like simple electric machinery, which will allow them to get a livelihood. And in this series, we then use brain waves to capture the brain waves and operate things based on that. So in case they have no other means of doing this, so in fact, one very famous case was I.M. Ahmedabad gentleman, the age of 32, he had a brainstem stroke. He lost his hand leg movement, he lost his voice, could only communicate through blink of his eyes. I'm not able to show you the video because the PDF form I did not have time for. This is a very short time we have. So this is actually he's operating with his head movement, we're tracking his movement, we're tracking his brain waves, and using his blink of eyes, we control the mouse click. Using his head movement, we control the mouse cursor, and he's able to operate the computer using this. In this particular case, he's controlling the environment using his eye blinks. Again, I'm not showing the video here. This is what he's written on his blog, I Can Type. After this, it's a long story here. There are many other people who have been using such systems. I'm going to leave out these details. Another thing we have been trying, not a successful person in vegetative state to capture the brain waves and allow them to communicate in some way. Here we look at three-dimensional brain movement. This is slightly away from a smart environment, but I thought it would be interesting to tell you about this. And we are extending this to cover identifying learning disabilities through the brain waves. Again, I'll leave out the details here, but you can see that, for example, there are other people who have been using such systems. She can try to speak through the system. She can try to control environment in wheelchair and all that through this. Let me leave out the details again. This is another one that is touch screen-based environment control system. So a person could, through their mobile phones or other things, touch screen or any other device can control everything around them. Let me leave out these details again, but the last two slides I wanted to show you was an integrated wheelchair project which allows to take input from users in any form possible, including brain waves, and make them do various things, including allow them to vote. This we are now working within the TIFAC, trying to develop a standard for this so that various units could be interfaced together once we develop the standard. It does not matter who develops it. So let me just finish the talk. I'm just giving a bigger name, network embedded system, which covers the various things we talk about, WS10, M2M, IoT, and so on. But it can affect us in many ways. So let me stop here. Thank you very much.